gather the outcasts of Israel, the dispersed of Judah from all the earth. You shall stand as an ensign for your people, and your resting place shall be glorious. You shall reign.
God has something for you, something great. So we just have to expect God to bring this miraculous into our midst. Hallelujah. Precious God. It was Day of Atonement just yesterday, by the way, on Thursday. And God has something to say through this feasts. God's feast is His calendar. It is His calendar. What God said to Israel, He says, Aviv, the month Aviv, which is April, shall be your first month. When God took Israel out of Egypt, He says, this is it. This is the beginning. This will be your new calendar. Here's month number one. Here's month number two. Yom Teriyot, which is Day of Trumpets. This is more like correct. Rosh Hashanah has been changed by rabbinical Judaism later, and they call this as of today a new year, the head of the new year. But it's not really a new year. But I guess they have their reason to call this a new year. I'm not going to get into this. So God really split the whole year in two different seasonal gifts. Four feasts. And four feasts are in the spring, and other three is in the fall. Now, God has specific reason for everything. God, what I love about God, I love many things about God, but, you know, He has certain things. He's so organized. He's so organized, and our life is running according to His course. Hallelujah. Precious God. So you don't have to be afraid. We are in the hands of God. We are in His hands. And He's looking after us daily. Not only looking, but the Bible says He is loading us daily with His benefits. He doesn't miss a day. He doesn't miss one day. Hallelujah. So we could trust in a God like that. So let me open with you to Leviticus chapter 16. How many of you love the book of Leviticus? I love it. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. We are not under the law. We're walking under grace, and this is wonderful. But we still can learn great things from the Old Testament. Hallelujah. Let me explain to you something important before I'm gonna teach from that. Today, I was kind of looking over this message, and I failed to tell you this. That the book of Exodus is the book of, or the message on deliverance and preparation. If you really carefully look through and study this book, you will realize that this book is about deliverance and preparation. Deliverance, you understand why? Because Jewish people, they were set free from Egypt. They were delivered. But preparation is because God said to build a tabernacle. God was preparing something. Though he set free the Jewish people from their bondage, yes, he did so, but that was not the end of the story. He just began. And at the Mount of Sinai, he gave them 10 suggestions. No? Commandments. Praise God. Hallelujah. And then he called Moses to the Mount of Sinai. He said, come over here, I'll give you the pattern. Because my next move is to come down and dwell among you. And you know that from 20th chapter all the way to 40th chapter, the tabernacle was to be built. And in chapter 40 of the book of Exodus, we know that when everything was prepared and ready, all of a sudden the Shekinah glory appeared upon the tabernacle, and even Moses could not enter in. It was so heavy. It was so heavy because God, first of all, came from heaven to the Mount of Sinai. Now he moved from the Mount of Sinai to the tabernacle. And from tabernacle of meetings, you know where he moved, eh? Right into your heart. You see that? So God doesn't do things unexpectedly right away. He prepares things. He does things in order. Hallelujah. So the book of Exodus is the book of deliverance, actually the message of deliverance and preparation. Now the book of Leviticus, if you're going to read carefully, and I would suggest you to read every, if you can. Somebody said, actually it was Reinhard Bonnke. He said, God spoke to him once and he said, read the book of Chronicles. He said, a book of Chronicles. He began to read and he says, it was to me like a telephone book. Names, and no numbers, just names and names and names. So sometimes we think that it's not important. So is the book of Leviticus. Sometimes it's boring. But when we begin to see what God is speaking to us, it becomes alive. So let me give you some insight about the book of Leviticus. The book of Leviticus is the book of Revelation. You see, if the book of Exodus is the book that speaks about deliverance and preparation, then the Jewish people were delivered and prepared for something. God had to finish the job. What they were prepared for revelation. God was giving them a revelation how to live daily. So the book of Leviticus is not just the book of the law and regulations. God was teaching the Jewish people how to live right before the Lord. Before God. What God was expecting from the Jewish people's life. And of course, the book of Numbers, you know what happens after the word of God has been revealed to you? God expects you to practice it. And if you're going to read the book of Numbers, you'll realize that the time came to practice what God has said. And that's where the Jewish people failed. Honestly, that's where the 12 spies were sent and they did not believe except two. That's where Miriam and Aaron actually went against Moses. That's where Robert met the road. And that's where God said, no, you're not ready. Even with everything I gave you, you're not ready. You're going to walk here for 40 years. I'm going to teach you a lesson. So the book of Deuteronomy speaks about reminders. God reminds in the book of Deuteronomy everything what he said. He was preparing the Jewish people 40 years by saying, remember what your parents did. Don't do that. When you come into the land, make sure that you obey my word. Isn't that interesting? Now, when you look into these things and when you begin to realize how God moves, you say, yeah, God is the God of order. Great time. 16th chapter of the book of Leviticus speaks about the Day of Atonement. Now, the book of Leviticus is the book of Revelation, remember? God reveals how to do things. Did you know that it is only in 23rd chapter that God spoke to Israel about the seven feasts, one after another? But in 16th chapter, listen to me carefully, this is very important. But way before, God explained how to behave on this particular feast. And it says, now the Lord spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron. After. You see, in chapter 10 of the book of Leviticus, we know this story. When two sons of Aaron came and brought wrong fire before the Lord. What is it, wrong fire? What does it mean to, what kind of wrong fire? To me, fire is fire. It flames. It burns. It's the same. But the intention was wrong. And God had to correct. Before God released the whole thing, he had to teach and correct and do certain things that people will understand what's going on, how to do these things right. So, those two boys, they fell dead. And God said, it was underlined in this chapter, after those two sons were dead, God spoke to Aaron and said, tell Aaron your brother not to come at any time into the holy place. See, why God was specific about this holy place and that the high priest would enter the Holy of Holies only once a year is because that's when God said that the high priest would bring a sacrifice for the whole nation once a year. Friends, listen to me carefully. You think about how specific God was, thinking about his mind, how specific he was when he was creating the heavens and the earth. He is so accurate and specific in everything because in God's kingdom, nothing lays wasted without doing nothing. Everything that God has created is for a purpose. That's why he says that God names every star in heaven. He knows the names. He knows every hair on your head. This is important. You were created specifically according to God's design. Therefore, God has something very specific for you. Hallelujah. God did not just create you as his child or whatever, whoever you will become. God has a specific plan and future for each and every one of you. Hallelujah. So that's why the Bible explains to us about the colors and all these things in the Bible. So what the white linen represents, it's the righteous acts of the saints. Read it with your own eyes. Revelations 19:8, it says, the white linen represents the righteous acts of the saints. Now, the high priest represented Yeshua. Do you understand that? That the high priest in the Old Testament represented Yeshua, who has become our high priest. Amen. So God was specific. He said, don't come to the Holy of Holies anytime you feel like, the way you want to approach me. Don't do that. Because it's the place for a high priest who is going to be the Messiah. And it cannot be everybody. It cannot be the way you want. It has to be a specific way, in specific time, for a specific purpose. It was very precious and holy. It was very important to God because God was preparing the way. And it's all about your and mine salvation, by the way. That's how important and precious it is. These specific things. You just think about the wedding. You know how many of you have been through weddings before? Preparations? I've been through my own wedding and I've been through my kids' weddings. And I know how precisely we would like to be. We even practice how we walk the aisle and what we're going to say and what we're going to do. Because this wedding is very important and it has to be nice and done exactly the way we want. This is very important time. This is very important moment. Imagine God was preparing the way for us to be saved. Just like that. He was making sure that everything is right and correct. He was making sure that everything is just His way. His way, just the way He said it. Even with colors. Even with colors. Another thing is, the Bible says to us that we have become the priests and Levites, the holy nation, the chosen generation. Why did we become priests and Levites? Because our Messiah is the high priest. We are not only the children of God because He was the firstborn, but we also became the priests and Levites because Jesus is the high priest. So we are after, we took after Him. Amen. And this is very, very important to understand. Now, let me come back to these colors and everything else, what God said here. And if you read from verse 4 and further on, you'll see that God was so precise about everything what was on Aaron from this white linen. It's powerful. Why God is so precise? When you approaching God today, whom does He see? Let's talk about colors and these materials and everything else. Why God is in colors and materials? Because when we approaching God, the Bible says that God has no partialities in men. It doesn't matter how we look, how tall we are, how good we look, it doesn't matter who we are in the flesh. I don't believe God looks upon our face and recognizes us like that. One time I was, when I was younger, a little bit younger believer, I went through certain things, I was going through certain things and I didn't have an answer from God and it frustrated me, it really frustrated me. So one time I was crying to God and I was beating my chest. I said, Lord, this is me, Gennady. Don't you understand? I was calling my name to the Lord just to remind Him that He may never forget that my name is Gennady, that He would answer me. He laughed. God said, Gennady, I don't see and I don't hear your name. I don't look upon your name. I look upon the blood of my son on you. Do you remember when Yeshua came, anointed by the Spirit, and began to minister in Luke chapter 4? When he began to approach the synagogue, the demons begin to manifest. Do you know why? Did they recognize his face or something else? They recognized on him the anointing of God. Listen to me carefully. The most important recognition that God recognizes you with or see you with and the devil see you with is who you are in the Messiah. When the anointing was upon Jesus, that's when the demons begin to scream. They were afraid because they saw the power of God on him. So when God said to Aaron, you have to dress yourself in white linen, it means that God wanted to see Aaron approaching God. And why white linen? Because white linen speaks about the righteous act. God loves righteous acts. Hallelujah. That's all it is. The righteous acts of the saints. Why God said in the book of Revelations that he's going to put on us white robes? Why white robes? Because the color white represents purity. Holiness. Hallelujah. That's how important it is to understand these things. Another thing is, when you are approaching God, when you're praying to God, don't remind him who you are. We don't have to say that. We don't have to say that. God sees who we are. He see it. Remember, there was a man in the Bible in the New Testament by the name of Cornelius, I believe. Cornelius. And Peter was praying in the top of the roof in Jaffa. And all of a sudden, God spoke to Peter in a vision. And he said, you have to go to this man who lived in Caesarea. And I'll tell you what to speak. Why to this man? Because this man, the Bible says, he paid alms to the synagogue. He did a lot of good things. And God saw those things. But that was not good enough. When Peter came to this house and began to speak, he began to speak about Jesus. What he was lacking, my friends, is salvation. You see? He was lacking the blood. God was looking upon this man for a while, upon his good deeds and this and that, but he was lacking the blood of the Messiah. And Peter was speaking. He even didn't finish speaking yet. When the Holy Spirit came upon him, his household, and everybody who was there, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak in tongues. And Peter was actually in awe. Amen. He thought, how could this be that the Spirit of God came upon the Gentiles? He was amazed. See, God was very much concerned about this man, that he did a lot of good things toward the Jewish people. So God sent Peter so that he may be saved. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Because God wanted to see on this man the blood. Now, reading further, we understand the next point here. And God said further for to Aaron to bring two goats. One goat for the sin offering, the other one is a scapegoat. The scapegoat was supposed to be running away into the wilderness. So one goat was to be killed, and the blood would be shed for first for Aaron and then for Israel, and the other goat was to be led out into the wilderness. What does this mean? What does this mean? This is another powerful point that we could talk about in Yom Kippur. The Bible says that Yeshua carried away our sins. Right? But where? I heard the cross. Somebody said to the cross. That was good. Tell me, what has happened to Yeshua when he died? According to the Bible, what has happened to him? The Bible tells me that he went to the lower parts of the earth. What purpose was it? Amen. He went to the lower parts of the earth to take the keys from Satan. That's number one. To proclaim the good news that he has paid the price to those people that died before. And I also believe that that's where your sins went, into the pit of hell. From where they came from, that's where they went. That's why the Bible speaks about two goats, that one will be killed, the other one will be just released and led into the wilderness, because your sins must be taken away. Taken away. And that's what God is doing. That's what God has done in your life. When he paid the price, he took the sins away. Away. He buried them back from where they came from. Do you know that your sin came from that place? Adam's sin. Satan put him there, and put him to sin, made him sin, and it really came from hell. So looking into these things, we begin to realize certain powerful things in our life. And there are a few. First of all, you and your sins are apart. They've been taken away. Your past is gone. What was in past, it's gone. It's over with. No more. Jesus has buried that. We have to understand this, that he has buried that. And we don't have to dig it back. We don't have to live in our past anymore. We don't have to think about our past. We don't have to be concerned about our past. We don't have to dwell in our past anymore. Because he already paid the price. It's gone. Secondly, remember as a new creation who you are in the Messiah. That's what we're missing a lot. What Jesus or what God is really sees upon us when we approach in him. And this is where really the powerful stuff comes in. When we understand. The Bible says that we were anointed. We are anointed. The Bible says in 1 Peter that nobody is supposed to teach you because the anointing will teach you. When we receive Jesus, when we are forgiven, when our sins are forgiven, the Holy Spirit comes in and he brings the anointing with him. The Bible also says that we are sealed by the Spirit of God. Sealed. Why we are sealed? Because what God sees is the Spirit of God upon you. Amen. Hallelujah. So you have to realize and recognize these three powerful things. What God is looking upon is the blood of the Messiah on you, is the seal of the Holy Spirit, and the anointing. The anointing upon you is visible as well. It must be. In spiritual eyes, it is. Glory to God. It's very important that we would walk in the under the anointing of God. This is the three things that you have to be concerned about. There's nothing else. Nothing else in our life matters more than this. And nothing else God really concerns about more than these things will be on our life. Because the Bible says that it is the blood, it is the anointing that destroys the yoke. Amen. It is the power of God that we need it most and foremost. Actually, it is the power of God that we need the most in our life. It is the power of God that deals with everything. Amen. It is the Spirit of God that is upon us. That's why God said in the book of Leviticus in chapter 16 that you would be specifically precise, Aaron. That you would do exactly what I say. That's what he said to Moses. You would do exactly what I say. Because certain things that God is paying attention to is to what he said. Is to what he has planted. Sometimes we approach in God on our own merit, the way we think it's best. It is through tradition. It is through our ancestors. Oh, that's how my parents worshiped. That's what I knew how God was doing things. Listen, we have to forget about these things. We have to get back into the Word of God and see which way God likes it. Amen. Which way God wants it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Which way God desires to do these things. And just remember the three important things in your life, which is the blood of Jesus, the seal of the Spirit, and the anointing, the most important things in your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, let's talk about the anointing a little bit. I love this subject. It's a great subject. It's a great subject. But the thing is this, that we always craving for more anointing. If God has given us the anointing, why do we need more? What is the purpose of this more anointing that we are looking for? And what is that purpose that God actually is looking for more anointing on you? Did you know that God also is looking for more anointing upon you? Anointing is just like faith. The Bible says, when I will be back on this earth, will I find faith? It's the same thing. It's the same thing. So let me trace back a little bit. The blood of Jesus, Yeshua, we received for free. It was grace given gift. The seal of the Spirit was given to us because of the blood of Yeshua. We were sealed by the Spirit. And we were given the anointing. We were given the anointing. The problem with many people today, that they are walking in the same level of the anointing that it was given to them. Listen to me carefully. This is very important. The problem with Christianity today, that most of Christians today walking in the same anointing that it was given to them. They walk in the same faith as when they have received Jesus. And there is no more. They walk in the same passion as they have passionate for God 15 years ago. This thing will not work. This thing doesn't work. Because the anointing is to be increased. You can clap your hands. That's fine. This is right. This is true. Let me explain to you something. Yeshua, when he came to this earth, this is great. He came as man. Yet he was God in the flesh, but he was as a man. Why did he pray nights? Why was he praying nights? Some nights he was just going away and prayed and prayed and prayed. is because that's where the anointing is laying. That's what we are lacking, my friends. See, whatever was given to us, we take it for granted. We've been taught many times over and over again that it's the gift of God. Enjoy it, have it, and just wait for Jesus to come back. This is true. But God said, listen, I gave you the power. See, the first church, the first messianic congregation that was established in Jerusalem under the supervision of Peter, they were so powerful. They were so powerful because they saw something further than we see today. They understood something, maybe because they were Jewish people and they knew the book of Leviticus. Maybe they begin to realize and recognize something precious through the scriptures that came to life through the New Testament. But they realized that God finally released His glory. Hallelujah! Do you know how important it was for the Jewish people to again experience the glory of Adonai? The Bible says and cries in the Old Testament many times over again, Lord, when our fathers were serving you, your glory was there, your power was there, they were dry as a bone. When Yeshua came, they were dry as a bone. Hallelujah. Do you understand that? They were dry. Now they begin slowly realize to realize who he was, and they were walking with him for 3.5 years and this and that. But Jesus said, do not depart from Jerusalem until when they have received the power of God, something has happened to them. They received the great portion of God, and they begin to realize and recognize, yes, that the Shekinah glory began to manifest again. See, they came back. Oh, this is important. They came back to their roots. Hallelujah. They came back to their roots. The problem with the church, that they don't know their roots. Hallelujah. But but the disciples came back to their roots. They came back to the place where they were in the wilderness, and they saw the glory of God manifesting. To them was no questions, no problems, because they came back to the very beginning, what they were looking for years, for centuries. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Father God, I come against every sickness and disease in this place in the name of Jesus. I bind the spirit of infirmity in the name of Jesus. And I command it to let go the children of God in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, let them go right now, Father. Hallelujah. Praise you. Praise you. Touch your people. Touch your people, Lord God. Touch your people. Let every sickness disappear in this place in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord. We just worship you, Lord God. We just praise your holy name. We just bless your holy name. Hallelujah. Just worship Him. Just worship Him. Just praise Him. Just bless Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Creative miracles. Let it be, oh God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Father. We praise your holy name. We bless your holy name. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, everybody, sing together with us. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God. Touch, touch your people, Lord God. Touch your people. Thank you, Lord Yeshua. We praise your holy name. We worship you, Lord. Different things are happening right now. Hallelujah, Lord God. God is touching somebody's stomach, abdomen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You feel a burning sensation right there. God is touching you right now in the name of Jesus. Glory, glory to God. Lord, touch, touch your people. Touch your people, Lord God. Touch your people. Let your healing anointing flow as it was never before, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah. We praise your holy name. We worship you, my Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed.
Ago, I was no longer able to use my knees to pick myself up off the floor, and 4 years ago I fell and badly hurt my shoulder, and I've been afraid since then of falling on the floor and not being able to get up. And I really have been restricted to not being able to do a lot of things because of my balance. And this morning I went to do what I couldn't do, so I went down to the floor. And then I was able to turn over, and then with the help of a little chair and a couple of people, Sister Svetlana put hands on me. And I could use my legs and my body as I haven't for 14 years.
Hallelujah.
And I thank the Lord for the healing.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.